This game is brought to you by Ed Mullinax Ford, East and West, with over 1,500 cars and trucks. By Miller Genuine Draft, cold filtered for real draft smoothness. It's beer at its best. And by the Plain Dealer, we're the heart of the city.
You're live on 19. WOIO Sports presents Cleveland State Basketball, Cleveland's home team. And you're looking at Woodling Gymnasium on the campus of Cleveland State University, where tonight the Vikings of Cleveland State, now 7-2 on the season, will look for their fifth consecutive victory, and they'll take on the Golden Griffins of Canisius. Canisius now 3-3 on the 86-87 campaign. Good evening, everybody. I'm Denny Schreiner, along with Alan Davis, and we're sitting in the wooden seats, or I should say on the wooden seats here at Woodling Gymnasium. A lot of times, pivotal players, they make the difference in basketball games, even coaches' strategies. But tonight, I have a feeling that the fans that sit in the wooden seats are going to make the difference.
Well, this is the 100th game that the Vikings have played here at Woodling Gym, and their record is a phenomenal 88-11 so far in the 99 games played. Under Kevin Mackey, 35-2, so you can't argue with that success.
Kevin would probably like to play each and every game here at Woodling Gymnasium. Vikings have won better than 87% of their games here. More importantly, though, it'll be a tough game tonight because Cleveland State nipped Canisius in Buffalo earlier this season, 66-61. It was a one-point basketball game, though, with just 6 seconds left, so tonight it will not be an easy victory.
And the crowd was a factor there, so I'm sure the crowd will be a factor here in favor of Cleveland State. Of course, the second time around, there are fewer surprises. Each team has already shown what it can do, and so a couple lineup changes tonight might prove interesting for both teams.
Well, Al and I will be back with the starting lineups for tonight's basketball game right after this timeout.
The Big Ten's Minnesota confronts Tennessee of the Southeastern Conference in the Liberty Bowl, here over the Raycom Sports Network. The Golden Gophers have shown upset ability all season long with their thrilling comeback against Michigan. Quarterback Ricky Foggy leads the attack on the Volunteers, the 1986 Sugar Bowl champions, after upsetting number one ranked Miami in postseason play last year. All the exciting Liberty Bowl action is here. Live on 19, Monday at 8.
When you feel a Big Mac attack coming on, get over to McDonald's fast, because right now you can get a Big Mac, golden fries, and a medium Coca-Cola for just $1.99. Is that a great deal? You can get a Big Mac, fries, and a medium Coke for only $1.99. But hurry before it's all gone.
Out on the street, beat never stops. When dawn breaks, another day starts. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. It's part of your life.
Start your day with the Plain Dealer. Call 344-4600 for home delivery.
Goodbye, Nissan.
Hello, savings.
This year in sale just got greater.
This week, 3.9. 3.9 at your local Nissan dealer. As low as 3.9 annual percentage rate on new hard body pickups. Or up to a whopping $800 cash back. Save over $1,460 with our $630 value plus package.
Sentra Economy. Maxima Luxury. ZX Site. Year end discounts. Lower payment. Last chance for tax saving. Goodbye, Nissan.
Hello, savings at your local Nissan dealers.
Thank you.
Welcome back, everybody. Denny Schreiner along with Alan Davis here at Woodling Gymnasium, and a rousing rendition by local product Rocco Scotty Allen. And if this game isn't enough to get the fans stoked up, obviously Rocco will help.
Well, Rocco definitely plays to the crowd, and I think the fact that he thought he might have been on TV also helped extend the length of the national anthem. And the way Rocco sings it, of course, is inimitable. It's almost as long as could be as long as the game itself.
Well, this will be the final test for the Vikings in 1986. Vikes will be off until January 12th when they'll take on Florida A&M, a basketball game that will be seen on 19, game number 3 of our coverage. And there you see Kevin Mackey, obviously a little bit concerned, I would think, Alan. As we mentioned in the pregame, 66-61 was the final victory margin over in Buffalo, but it was a very, very tough W to come by.
And we keep referring to the fact that the schedule this year is much tougher for Cleveland State overall. It was ranked by USA Today as the 33rd toughest schedule in the nation. And I'm sure, though, that Kevin would not have scheduled such tough opponents had he known what was going to happen this season. Of course, the death of Paul Stewart, the injury to Eric Mudd, who, by the way, is now out for the rest of the year, and all the other academic problems that he had with the two junior college transfer kids who didn't graduate on time. So had he known then what he knows now, he definitely would not have been playing Canisius, let alone twice this season.
Let's look back briefly in retrospect at the game against Canisius. It was a ball game, basically, where the Vikings were forced into 32 turnovers. Now, that's a lot of miscues, and they still came away with a victory. Canisius, a very good team at taking the basketball away from them.
They're a very good defensive team also. They baffled the Vikes on several occasions, changing zones, and they will do that. They will play different defenses every time Cleveland State brings the ball down the floor. They may play a 1-3-1, they may play a 1-2-2 match zone, or they might play a man-to-man, and the Vikings never really know what's going on until they set up the offense.
As Alan mentioned in the pregame as well, there will be some changes tonight as far as the starters are concerned for the Golden Griffins of Canisius. And at this point, Nick, their head coach, Nick McCutcheon, is in a position where he is still looking for a starting five that's playing together and playing well. And now we're going to have the introduction of tonight's starting lineups, handled locally by Joe Jastrzemski.
Canisius College and the Vikings of Cleveland State University. Introducing tonight's starting lineups for Canisius at forward, number 12, a 6'2 sophomore from Norristown, Pennsylvania, Grady Minnick. For Cleveland State at forward, number 44, a 6'5 senior from Toledo, Ohio, Clinton Ramsey. For Canisius at forward, number 44, a 6'5 sophomore from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Marvin Bailey. For Cleveland State at forward, number 32, a 6'5 senior from Euclid, Ohio, Pat Vianchik. For Canisius at center, number 50, a 6'7 senior from North Collins, New York, Chris Heinhold. For Cleveland State at center, number 23, a 6'5 junior from East Cleveland, Ohio, Hersey Strong. For Canisius at guard, number 10, a 6'3 junior from Williamsville, New York, Nick McCarchuk. For Cleveland State at guard, number 10, a 6'1 sophomore from New York, New York, the Mouse, Ken McFadden. For Canisius at guard, number 32, a 6'2 junior from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Brian Smith. For Cleveland State at guard, number 5, a 5'10 senior from Dorchester, Massachusetts, Eddie Bryant. Ladies and gentlemen, Canisius is coached by Mr. Nick McCarchuk. Cleveland State is coached by Mr. Kevin Mackey, assisted by Eric Schanenberger, Ron Schwartz, and Leo Papillo. The officials for tonight's contest, Mr. Jim Murphy and Mr. Murph Shapiro.
Be interesting to find out whether or not Cleveland State, Alan Davis, can come up with a victory tonight and start, in essence, the same way they did last season with an 8-2 record.
That is correct. Of course, last year, those two losses, one of them, I recall, was to Ohio State, and the other one was to Michigan, two Big Ten opponents, and they don't have a Big Ten opponent on the schedule this year. The two losses this season, of course, the Memphis State loss in the NIT preseason, and then that heartbreaker down in Akron, 4 points in overtime.
Vikings will open up conference play on January 17th on the road against Western Illinois, with University of Wisconsin and Green Bay knocking off Northwestern last night, with the University of Illinois Chicago beating Michigan State a couple of weeks ago. It could be a long go in the conference this season.
I talked to assistant coach Ron Swartz, who just came in from that trip, by the way. He watched that Wisconsin-Green Bay victory. He said there is no sure win in the conference this season. So it'll be interesting, because Dick Bennett is trying to do a job up there at Wisconsin-Green Bay, and I think right now he's turning the program around.
Well, the Vikings scored 99 in their last victory against Maryland Eastern Shore the other night. Don't think they'll get to the century mark this evening, but a W would be sweet. Opening tap is controlled by the Golden Griffins.
Talked a little bit about the change in the lineup. Pat Vianchik, you saw there jumping center, and Hersey Strong is starting at the center position in place of Warren Bradley. Coach Kevin Mackey making some changes just to see if he can get more offensive production out of his starters.
First jumper is no good. There's a fight for the basketball, and underneath, Vianchik came up with it, but I have a feeling somebody stepped on the out-of-bounds line. So full court pressure employed by Canisius.
And they will do that on occasion. They won't do it every time down the floor, but they will do it every so often.
Guarantee you, if the Vikings break it as easy as they did that time, they won't press. Vianchik called for going up over the top, so Clinton Ramsey could not come up with the basket inside, and Vianchik gets whistled for the personal.
And now, of course, Cleveland State will employ its own press.
They say the teams that normally press all the time don't like to be pressed. We'll have to see how that happens in this one. Ball is loose. It's on the floor. Now we've got a jump ball as the Mouse tied up Grady Minnick.
And that'll go Cleveland State's way on the alternating possession rule.
Good hustle that time by number 10. Ball was on the floor. If you put it on the floor and leave it there for any length of time, Cleveland State will probably come up with it. Probably see a little 1-3-1 to start here from Canisius, and they will alternate defenses every trip down the floor. If they do one thing especially well, it's change up those defenses. No score in the early go here at Woodling Gymnasium. Vianchik in a crowd has the ball slapped out of his hands by Brian Smith, but Cleveland State retains.
Pat Vianchik, of course, a story that we will develop as the game goes along. A walk-on who has been rewarded with a scholarship for his hard efforts.
Vikings being very patient. Now the Mouse will pull up and try his first effort. Shot no good. Ball is battled for, and a nice rebound save by Smith. Both teams playing at a high intensity level, but still no score here.
We should note the change in the starting lineup for Canisius. They have Marvin Grady Minnick in the lineup. He did not play the last time against Cleveland State.
Great steal by Eddie Bryant, and nearly converted the fast break bucket. And we of course would like to invite and say hello to all of our national fans, Cleveland State basketball fans on Score. Over 19 million subscribers from coast to coast who obviously are enjoying Cleveland State basketball. Vikings need a bucket. Eddie Bryant with a long-range rainbow. No good. Boy, oh boy. What a battle for the basketball, and it's off the fingertips of number 44, Marvin Bailey, and Cleveland State will retain possession.
And Vikings. Pat Vianchik, Mr. Hustle, was in the middle of that.
And that's the way to get the evening started as Kenny McFadden hits a three-point goal. Eddie Bryant with a near steal. Kevin Mackey is beside himself, wanted the foul called, but the official said no. Bryant stepped on the line. And Kevin right now going through some theatrics, but I don't think he's going to change anybody's mind.
We have a substitution for Canisius. Jeff Taggart is in for Grady Minnick. Grady was only making his first start of the season this year, recovering from a car accident and an ankle injury as Cleveland State makes the steal.
There's the steal, and the Mouse McFadden now has all 5 points for Cleveland State. And the pressure beginning to show early on here. Canisius breaks the press. Oh, back down the other way. Near jam. Whistling a foul on Vianchik. That's his second. And Marvin Bailey tried the left-handed high percentage shot. but couldn't make it.
Marvin Bailey, perhaps the most promising newcomer on the Canisius squad. Transfer from Mount San Antonio Junior College in California. Did not play last year because he only attended there 1 year.
Warren Bradley, big double zero, checks in for Pat Vianchek. At the free shot line is Marvin Bailey, and he has been a study in futility from the free shot line this season, shooting 35.9%. Still 5-0. Vikings pitching a shutout in the early go, 17:49 remaining in the opening half. 1-for-2, so Bailey erases the goose egg. Canisius with some good full court pressure of their own.
It's surprising that they've come out with a press both times down.
Vikings are going to have to hurry. Hersey Strong gets it across the timeline. The Mouse saves it barely before it goes out of bounds. And you got to give the Golden Griffins some credit. Did a nice job defensively that time. Mike's working the perimeter. Quentin Ramsey's shot won't go. Big rebound off the backboard by Taggart.
That's usually Clinton's spot, too. Maybe he just needs a little while to get warmed up.
It won't take long at the rate they're playing here this evening. Lob down low to Heinold, establishes position, and turns around, shoots it in. Tough shot in tough territory, but Heinold with his first bucket.
He's their leading scorer, and I think he showed you there why.
Oh, beautiful move inside as the Mouse, unattended, hits the bucket. McFadden now with 7, and he has scored all of Cleveland State's points. He's off to a very quick start.
Well, he had 22 against Canisius the first time out.
Beautiful reverse layup that time by Marvin Bailey. Bailey now has 3. There's a steal. Oh, this is going to be end to end, I have a feeling, this evening. Sean Hood and also Ray Salders up off Kevin Mackey's bench, and they'll check in at first opportunity. 7-5. It's the Vikes by a bucket. 16.5 minutes left here in the opening half. We've got a whistle and a foul down low, and that one is called on Eddie Bryant.
Eddie Bryant guarding a little too close, and I think the officials, Jim Murphy and Murph Shapiro, are going to make sure that there isn't a lot of bagging under the basket.
Jumper from the corner, no good. Heinold with a rebound, put back. That won't go. There's a battle for it, and Canisius comes off with it. Now it's on the floor, and Cleveland State will run it back the other way.
Nice dribbling there by Ken McFadden between the legs.
Hersey Strong with no room to operate, takes it up, crashes the boards. There's a whistle and a foul on the starting center, number 50, Chris Heinold, and Hersey Strong, who just loves the baseline, will head to the free shot line.
Well, Hersey is going to make the most out of this starting ability. You know, he lost, or starting opportunity, I should say. He lost his starting position in the 6th game and has played well since then, though, with 48 points in the 4 games that he has come up off the bench. So he's being rewarded by getting a starting spot tonight.
Hersey on the season shooting just a fraction better than 69% from the foul line, shooting 49% from the field. Can't buy either of those. 7-5, Cleveland State on top. Mouse McFadden with all 7 points for Cleveland State.
Vikings are Jekyll and Hyde on the free throw line.
You're right. Some nights it's good. Some nights you don't even want to think about it. Taggart with a wing shot that won't go. Bailey with a tough rebound inside, and Marvin Bailey with a fallaway jumper ties the score at 7.
Bailey has 5 of those 7 points.
Beautiful feed that time inside. Whistle and a foul. Salders will head to the free throw line. Sean Hood smiles at Ray Salders and said, "Ray, why didn't you power it up the first time I gave it to you?"
Well, here is Ray Salders going up for the shot, and Bailey just jumped and whacked right into him. And I think Coach Nick McCarchick was a little upset because he felt it should have been an offensive foul. It looked like Ray wanted to make sure that he got the foul call, so he sort of leaned in a little bit too, but Bailey definitely was on his way up and across.
Bailey did an excellent job of keeping his feet on the ground, didn't go for the pump fake, but Ray finally got him up in the air.
Gray, of course, a native of Buffalo and was recruited by Canisius that wanted to get away from home, so he chose Cleveland State as instead. So I think he's a little bit extra pumped up.
And we've got a timeout on the floor. So with 15:30 left here in the opening half, it's Cleveland State 8 and Canisius 7. You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
Experience the look, the feeling of satisfaction. The 1987 Mercur XR4 Ti, an excitingly different European sports coupe. Now you can lease one through Ford Credit's red carpet lease plan for just $299 per month, including use tax. Experience the styling, the performance, the smooth handling. Hurry in and lease the new Mercur XR4 Ti for just $299 per month with a red carpet lease from Ford Credit. See your Lincoln Mercury Mercur dealer today.
On the next 700 Club. 7 years ago, the Soviets invaded Afghanistan, and today the suffering continues. The tortures and abuses being committed are shocking.
This is the worst situation that man has ever seen.
How long can the Afghan people resist? And hear the music of Phil Driscoll as he sings and plays A Song of Peace. All this and much more on the next 700 Club.
Welcome back, everybody. Danny Schreiner along with Alan Davis at Whittling Gymnasium. There you see it. 8-7, Vikings on top by a point. 66-61 was the score when they first met in Buffalo. The Vikings won, but it was a hard-fought victory.
Well, you know, this is not a bad team. They've won 20 games each of the last two seasons. In fact, they were 21-8 last year. So right now, Coach Makarchik is struggling to find a winning combination. They're 3-3, but they won't be 3-3 for long.
Turnover forced by that pressure Cleveland State defense. Nick Makarchik the third. Obviously the coach's son. His gold medal there. Wonder if Dad will talk to him about that one on the bus ride home tonight.
That's the bad part about playing for your dad. You never leave the game at the court.
Yeah, over the dinner table, you always have to chat about it. Vikings off to a bit of a slow start.
I wonder if that works the other way, too. If the coach makes a tactical mistake, does his son tell him about it?
Not if he wants to keep playing. The Mouse on the wing. Beautiful jumper by Kenny McFadden, who now has 9. 10-7, Vikings by 3.
Well, they say the Mouse gets up for the big games. I guess he considers this one a big one.
Near turnover created there, and play number 4 called out by Nick McCarchick.
Vikings in a man-to-man defense.
Boy, beautiful pick set down low, and Marvin Bailey was left unattended. Bailey now with 7. Salters gets whistled for traveling at the other end, so turnabout is fair play. Canisius creates a turnover, a mental error, with air full court pressure.
Unfortunate, too, because he flipped that ball up and it went in. And we could have had a basket.
10-9, Vikings by a point. Trying to win number 5 in a row, number 8 on the season. There's a scramble. Ball's on the floor, and Bianchik comes up with it. A flash in the lane. Salters loses it. There's a dive. Ball's on the floor, and a jump ball is called. Alternating possession, and the basketball will go to Canisius.
During that last dead ball, the Golden Griffin substituted Marvin Bailey, or rather Jamil Mosley, into the lineup. And Salters gets whistled for the personal.
That is Ray's first personal foul. Team foul number 4 against the Vikings. 10-9 is our score. 14:09 remaining here in the opening half.
Kenny Robertson now coming into the ball game. Kenny coming off a great game against Maryland Eastern Shore. 10 points, his collegiate high so far. And one tremendous slam dunk that really brought the crowd to its feet.
He is a gifted athlete, no question about that. Heinle down low, double team, throws it up, shot no good, rebound, follow is no good, and Robertson, who just checks into the lineup, gets whistled for his first personal foul. And you've got to give credit where credit is due. Canisius doing a nice job of boxing out and getting some offensive rebounds.
And Heinle doing a great job at playing the center position. He hasn't played it for a year or so. He was a forward last year, and he's been playing a forward so far this season.
Brian Smith heads to the free shot line. Smith scored 10 points in the game played earlier this year against Cleveland State. Her shot is up and no good. Smith shooting 85% from the free throw line on the season, and he's shooting better than 54% from the field, and I'm told that he's probably the best all-around athlete that Canisius has on the floor.
6'2½, 199-pound junior from the city of brotherly love, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Smith sits down, and Michael Ray Jackson will check in. We're all tied at 10 apiece, 13:55 left here in the opening half.
Griffin's played 10 men just like the Vikings do, so we're going to see a lot of substitutions, and I'm sure that we're not going to keep track of all of them. Probably wonder ourselves, where'd that guy come from? We didn't see him come in.
Salters with a nice baseline jumper move. The shot was no good, but a whistle and a personal foul. Personal called on Pat Vianchek. And for Pat, very quickly, he has notched his third personal foul. Hersey Strong checks in immediately, and Vianchek may be done for the first half.
That is unfortunate, because Pat is a guy that you want in there because he always creates something anytime he's around the ball.
Golden Griffins have obviously shown up to play here this evening. Smaller college located in Buffalo. Many people don't realize what a good program they really have.
And it's all because of Nick McCarchick, who's been there now 10 seasons. This is his 10th season. And he turned a program around that was really, Canisius was considering dropping basketball about 10 years ago before he came, or at least.
There's a steal. Kenny Robertson loading it up, takes it to the glass. Shot no good. Follow is up, though, by Warren Bradley. And a steal very quickly. Ball checked out of bounds, and Cleveland State loses the handle on it. Kenny Robertson, when he checks into the lineup, something will happen. I'll guarantee that.
I almost said before Ray Salters lost that ball that maybe this is the time for one of those patented Cleveland State runs.
Kenny Robertson with a near steal right in front of head coach Kevin Mackey. But a whistle and a personal foul. Elgin Womack will check into the Cleveland State lineup, and this is the first that the 6'9" senior has played in the 86-87 season.
Elgin is coming off of arthroscopic knee surgery. Took a little longer to recover than normal, but now with Eric Mudd out for the season, Elgin's play is going to be very pivotal in this 1986-87 season.
Michael Ray Jackson, 6 foot, 189-pound senior guard at the free shot line. No good. Womack beat on the backboards, and the bucket is up and good by Dwight Garrett. Garrett with his first hoop, and we're tied again at 12. Salters, spin move, hesitation, jumper, and he hit it. Ray Salters with a dandy of a move down low. Tough shot inside and heavy traffic. Salters is deceiving, only 6'2", but he's got great hang time. Garrett with a skip pass over the zone. Well, he's playing a lot of man-to-man tonight. Garrett, who just checks in, tosses it away.
You know, in that first game between Canisius and Cleveland State, there were 59 turnovers in the game. The Vikings forced the Griffins into 27, but committed 32 themselves, which is very uncharacteristic. But, of course, the Griffin defense had a lot to do with that.
Sean Hood calls out play number 4, and that one came directly from Kevin Mackey. Vikings have had a tough time getting the ball inside against the pressure. Now Sean penetrates. Throws up the running one-hander, and Taggart comes down with the air special.
He had to alter his shot there a little bit in the lane.
Excellent penetration move, but he couldn't find anybody to dump it off to either. The 11:38 remaining here in the first half. 14-12, Vikings by 2 in a low-scoring affair. Taggart, nobody to pass it to. He shoots it, and Hersey Strong comes off with a loose ball. Vikings press the action. Ramsey inside, stripped of the basketball, whistle, and a personal foul on Michael Ray Jackson. First personal on Jackson, third team foul.
Let's take a look at it now as Clinton driving the lane, but you saw that after he got fouled, he did the wise thing. He went up for the shot.
And we've got a timeout on the floor. So with 11:22 left here in the first half of play, the score is Cleveland State 14. Canisius only a bucket behind. You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
Hi, I'm Ed Mullinex. Every car, every truck is on sale during our six-day year-end sell down. It's a buyer's market at Mullinex Ford, east or west, with over 1,500 cars and trucks. Buy any new Ford and get a $300 to $600 cash rebate. It's our goal to reduce our inventory by about 300 units. And now is your last chance for a tax break. Take a test drive this week, and we'll give you a video tax guide just for shopping at Mullinex Ford, east or west.
Florida State, the nation's sixth best offense, is spearheaded by quarterback Danny McManus. The ground game is controlled by the awesome Sammy Smith. The defense is led by All-American Deion Sanders. Indiana, All-American sack machine Van Waiters puts fear into the hearts of quarterbacks. Freshman sensation Anthony Thompson and Damon Swayze bulldoze their way towards the end zone. The Seminoles, the Hoosiers, New Year's Eve fireworks explode on the gridiron, the All-American Bowl.
Live on 19, Wednesday at 8.
Vikings have the basketball and a two-point advantage. It's 14-12 here at Whittling Gymnasium with 11:22 remaining here in the opening half.
The officials evidently weren't fooled on that last foul. Clinton was trying to get two shots out of it from the free throw line, but they just considered it a common foul, so he will not get the two shots, but the Vikings still have the basketball.
Canisius now laying back in that zone. Eddie Bryant will try from the right wing. Ball batted around and Taggart comes off with it. I have to be impressed with the way the Canisius has handled themselves on the backboard. Boy, they've done a nice job. Most teams don't rebound that well against the Vikings.
You know, Marvin Bailey is listed at 6'5 and a half, and I believe that he's a little taller than that.
That's the old decoy in the book. A lot of patience being shown right now. I think Golden Griffin's realizing it has to be a low-scoring affair for them to win. They get it to Heinold, turns around and shoots it. Heinold now with four, and they go to their money player when they do need a basket. Ramsey on the wing, score. Running one-hander. Ramsey's first bucket of the evening. Clinton Ramsey averaging nearly 17 points a game.
And 1,569 points now for his career, second leading all-time scorer in CSU history.
The fans wanted a traveling call there, and so did Kevin Mackey. Unfortunately, they didn't get the call. Excellent crowd on hand. It's a sellout.
And there will be plenty of those. Front.
Michael Ray Jackson passed it through the zone. McCarchick with a pump fake shot blocked by Womack. Three on one break. Eddie Bryant takes it inside, running one hander and he scores. 18-14, Vikings by four.
And there you saw the importance of Elgin Womack to this basketball team. He's got those long extender arms and he can block shots.
Here's another steal. The run is on. Ramsey with a basket inside. Ramsey with four. And it's time to circle the wagons. Canisius calls time with 9 minutes and 11 seconds remaining here in the first half of play. Cleveland State leading this one 20-14. And the faithful here, obviously, Alan Davis, pretty pleased with what's just transpired.
And, of course, we've talked about the home court advantage. We talked about that at the top of the show, and there you can see the crowds. And let's take a look at Clinton Ramsey on this drive. Really not too complicated. Just lay it up, use the glass, and put it in nice and smoothly.
Did you notice how Ramsey used his body to shield off the player?
Well, he does that for two reasons, as we see the 1,570 points, third highest in MQA history. It's the second highest in Cleveland State history, and, of course, I don't think that he's going to reach Franklin Edwards' 2,235 for a career, but he certainly had a very stellar career here at Cleveland State in his fourth year.
The next Cleveland State basketball game on WOIO 19 coming your way on January 12th. That's 1987, CSU versus Florida A&M. And game time, there you see it, scheduled for 8 o'clock sharp. Vikings lead by 6. It's 20-14. 9-11 left here in the first half, and it's been a squeaker thus far.
We have Greg Lockhart now in for the Vikings, replacing Elgin Womack.
Golden Griffs break the pressure, and now they'll bring it back out front and set it up.
And notice what they're doing, Denny. They're passing over the press. That can be a dangerous pass. When you've got tall guys like Canisius has, I guess it'll be effective.
Kenny McFadden stopping by with a little weak side, backside defense help for Warren Bradley, but he got whistled, for the swat. Here you see the lob down low.
Look at this. I thought he had just ball, but, well, you can't tell from that angle, but I really thought he just slapped the ball. I didn't hear him. You can tell a difference of arm upon arm as opposed to arm upon ball. Let's look at it again. Boy, I don't know.
Pretty tough to see from that angle.
Well, Heinold's at the line anyway, and he made the first one.
Chris Heinold now with 5 on the even, scored 10 against CSU earlier this season. Gets a pair from the free throw line. Heinold at one stretch made 26 of 27 free shots this year, 24 in a row, so he will make it from the charity stripe. Vikes lead by 4 at 20-16.
Greg Lockhart got his hands on that ball. I thought he was going to take it for a minute.
Take the shot?
Yes.
Yeah, I know one thing. If he didn't make it, he'd have been sitting down next to Kevin Mackey. You don't check into the lineup
probably
and shoot.
On the end of the bench, never to be heard from again.
Yeah, you don't shoot first time down the floor. The Mouse with a nice move inside. Shot no good. Big rebound. Whistle and a foul down low on Greg Lockhart. Marvin Bailey with a nice box-out move that time.
And the Golden Griffins are now in a bonus situation. So every foul now will be important because the Griffins will get a chance at the line.
Canisius on the season shooting 73% from the charity stripe, which is pretty solid. Bailey now with 8 points on the night, and he leads the Canisius scoring. Chris Heinold has 6 thus far. Could cut the lead to 2. And he does.
Now the Griffins only putting on a half-court press.
Back into that 1-2-2 zone. Multiple defenses. Of course, most college basketball teams are employing that tactic. Uh-oh, 3-point shot by Clinton Ramsey, who wanted to take it the last trip down the floor and opted not to. Ramsey now with 7.
That is his first of the season, and he's only one of 3 guys that has the green light to shoot that any time that he feels like it.
He must have watched Kentucky's Rex Chapman shoot a little bit on Saturday afternoon, Alan. What do you think?
Maybe so.
Chapman just destroyed the defending champion Louisville Cardinals from 3-point range. Uh-oh, ball tapped loose. Eddie Bryant saves it with a dandy. The Mouse takes it inside, lays it on the glass.
Great peripheral vision by Eddie Bryant. He just sort of slapped it to a spot knowing that Kenny McFadden would be there. I'm sure he didn't see him. He must have eyes in the back of his head if he did.
Biggest lead of the night for the Vikings at 7 points, 25-18. 7 minutes remaining. Taggart with a move inside, running left-hander, no good, and the Vikings are on the move again. Bryant left wing, pump fake, nowhere to go, throws it up, shot no good, but an offensive foul is called.
And that was a good call. Eddie leaned in thinking that he might get the personal call on his opponent.
And we've got a timeout on the floor. So with 6 minutes and 54 seconds left here in the opening half, our score is Cleveland State 25, Canisius 18. You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
It started out as a party, but turned into a case of the missing case.
The groovy shindig.
We'll turn out the lights!
Oh, Mickey!
It's okay, doll.
No, it's not. There's a case of Miller Lite missing.
Oh. Who took it?
Somebody in this room.
Rodney!
Hey, guys, take it easy, will you?
Why'd you do it, Rodney? Cause light tastes great?
Yeah!
Cause light's less filling.
Yeah! I didn't do it.
Well, I'm not even Rodney.
You! I thought it was a costume party. Great mask, huh?
But if he didn't do it, who did?
They'll never figure out who took that case.
Oh, Mickey, you did!
Not exactly.
Hiya, doll.
Gotcha.
Well, I'm glad we didn't go dancing.
It's no mystery that there's only one light beer, Miller.
6:54 remaining in the opening stanza, and Cleveland State now leads by 7, but it hasn't been easy, 25-18. Percy Strong back in the lineup, as is Ray Salters. Salters with a steal, and a push, though, called about midcourt on number 50, Chris Heinold, who looks a little bit frustrated at this point, Alan Davis.
Yes, he certainly does. He committed 4 personals against the Vikings the last time. I think he was frustrated because he lost the ball and he wanted to go after it, and instead went after Ray Salters.
Unfortunately, Ray was between the ball and Chris. That's where the problem therein lied.
You know, the Vikings, actually I should say the Golden Griffins, had 3 players foul out of that first game, so it was a physical battle.
Maybe Mackey said we were glad we got out of there with our lives. 20 left on the shot clock.
Both teams making some very interesting passes as Sean Hood loses the ball there.
Sean bounced it off his foot, but a steal back the other way by Warren Bradley. Nice hustle
great
by the big man.
Defensive work.
Salters inside in traffic. Shot is good. Whistle and a foul. Salters now with 5 on the night, and he could increase the Vikings' lead to 10.
Boy, Ray Salters playing the game of his life so far in the early going. Watch this. He fakes the shot, takes the dribble, and he got slapped by Minnick. I don't know if you saw it on the way up.
Grady Minnick with his first personal foul. Salters hits the free throw. Ray now with a half dozen on the night. Kenny Robertson checks back in, and the Mouse McFadden will sit down. 28-18, CSU's biggest lead of the evening.
And the Vikings in their 55 zone press, 1-2-1-1.
Probably their best zone press. I imagine Canisius will get tired of looking at it before the night's over. Under 6 minutes to play here in the opening half. Steal and a foul from behind, and each and every time down the floor, the overall quickness of Cleveland State beginning to play more and more of a factor in this one.
Marvin Bailey's going to get called for this one. Watch Hood. He's so small, and you wonder how a 5'7" guy, what business he has out there on a court with a bunch of 6'5" guys. But look at this. This is sometimes where it pays to be small, because you can sneak right up under, make no contact, but the other guy makes contact with you.
Great anticipation, and it'll be a very good defensive player. You have to anticipate. Salters wanted to pull the trigger, but decided the better that time.
I was going to say, Sean Hood and Eddie Bryant, two of the first guys that Mackey recruited his first year here, and everybody sort of raised eyebrows when they heard about it.
13 left on the shot clock. Now it's under 10. Percy pulls up, takes the jumper, no good. Robertson went high for the rebound, but couldn't come down with a basketball.
I'll tell you what, before this guy's career is over at Cleveland State, you're going to see this young man do some amazing things.
Well, both elbows were above the rim that time, and Robertson just couldn't snare the basketball. Fans booing Canisius because they didn't take the layup opportunity. But obviously, the Golden Griffs are going to slow this one down. If they don't, and they let this become a horse race, it could be over in a hurry.
And Ray Salters gets called for a second personal, and that will send Grady Minnick to the line. And Elgin Womack back into the ball game, replacing Warren Bradley.
Elgin, what do you think at this point? Probably about 85-90%, Alan?
If that much. But I'm sure that he's being pressed into service a little quicker than Kevin Mackey would like him to, but it's out of sheer necessity.
Minnick with his first point on the night. Grady Minnick, 6'2", 205-pound sophomore guard, with a pair of free shots.
Michael Ray Jackson now into the ballgame for the Golden Griffins. I like that name, Michael Ray Jackson.
Sporting that Carl Lewis hairstyle. Yeah, is it Michael Jackson or Michael Ray Richardson?
Right.
It's a toss-up. 28-20, Vikings by 8. 4.5 left here in the first half. Three-point shot, no good. Saunders keeps it alive. Uh-oh, can't make the bunny down low, and Heinold comes off with a rebound. Taggart on the move, kicks it backwards, and Jackson can't run it down. And it was a three-on-one break that ended up in a turnover, and that'll give coaches gray hairs.
That's one time when selfishness is probably the better thing to do. He should have gone for the shot himself, as you see Nick McCarchick probably telling him the same thing there. He really didn't see anybody back there, but he should have gone for it himself. Try to be unselfish, passed off, and instead it resulted in a turnover.
Clinton Ramsey reinserted into Cleveland State's lineup. Vikings have been very patient on offense, half court wise. And just as I say that, Hersey Strong takes a 20 footer that doesn't hit anything. Another turnover, another unforced error. Nick McCarchuk right now is going to wear out a brand new pair of shoes if his team continues the turnovers, as we've got a timeout now on the floor with 3 minutes, 43 seconds left in the opening half. The score, Cleveland State 28, Canisius 20, and you're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
BlauShield Schicker Nissan, Northern Ohio's Nissan sales leader. Full line of 87s available for sale or lease. The sporty yet luxurious Maximas. The redesigned practical Stanzas. Sentra's affordability in a wide range of models. Come in and test drive and find out how being number one makes you number one. BlauShield Schicker Nissan. 16101 Chagrin, 4 miles west of I-271 in beautiful Shaker Heights. Serving Cleveland since 1914. Call 751-8100.
You feel a Big Mac attack coming on. Get over to McDonald's fast, because right now you can get a Big Mac, golden fries, and a medium Coca-Cola for just $1.99. Is that a great deal? You can get a Big Mac, fries, and a medium Coke for only $1.99. But hurry before it's all gone.
Vikings led by as many as 10. The lead now has been shaved to 8. Had one nice spurt, but to Allen Davis, the 8-point lead has been hard fought here this evening.
Well, they had leads in Buffalo, too, when they played Canisius the first time, but lost them. Actually, at halftime of that game, they were trailing by 1 point, 30-29. And you can see as Elgin Womack gets hacked as he goes up for the shot.
Elgin being bumped in the paint that time, sort of rolled his eyes after the foul was called. And when you do come off any kind of surgery, whether it's ankle or knee, you have a tendency to be a little bit tentative, and here you'll see it. Nice to get the ball inside to the big guy and make him work for it a little bit, but boy, when you have to test it under fire the first couple of times out, it's a little scary.
Well, Elgin has a nice shot, a nice little short jump hook, and he's very quick with his release, and he will draw those fouls. Now the question is whether he can convert, and you see there the effects of the long layoff. He is he missed his first free throw, of course, when it comes to Cleveland State players. That could be said for just about any one of them.
Yeah, but he made amends there. 1 for 2 on the brand new season. Elgin will sit down, big double zero. Lauren Bradley checks in. And Eddie Bryant also back in the Cleveland State lineup. Sean Hood getting a rest.
Boy, but it's good to see Elgin playing. He can make such a valuable contribution to the team this year, and it's a chance that he's waited for all 4 years that he has been here at Cleveland State. It's been a very frustrating career for him.
Well, with injuries, Kevin Mackey right now at a shortage as far as front court players are concerned, so the sooner Elgin comes back and gets involved, the better off the Vikings will be. 29-20, it's a 9-point spread. Near steal out front. Nice penetration move that time by Grady Minnick. who ran over a couple of people in the process as Greg Lockhart gets up off the green paint inside. And it's tough when you have to try and establish position defensively when one of those guards is taken off at the foul line.
Well, here's the situation where Minnick got past Clinton Ramsey with that quick move, and Eddie Bryant had no choice but to foul him to stop what was definitely going to be a two-point basket. Actually, gee, I thought McFadden got it before Bryant did.
You're watching Cleveland State basketball on WOIO 19, Shaker Heights, Cleveland. Minnick misses the free throw, and the Mouse comes off for the basketball. Vikings are averaging better than 86 points a game this season. They're well under that mark at this stage. Offensive foul called on the spin move. Warren Bradley with a shoulder as Marvin Bailey took the plunge.
And Kevin Mackey did not like that call at all. I don't know if he didn't like the call or he didn't like the fact that Warren made that move. Of course, Coach Mackey is not expecting a lot of scoring out of Warren. He's told him, just get me the rebounds and be aggressive on those boards. And so far he's done that. He averaged 7.9 rebounds per game so far this season.
Conference play hasn't started yet, but according to those current stats, Warren is the leading rebounder in the MQ8 conference. Now Lockhart down low trying to establish position. Pushed Marvin Bailey right out of the paint and get called for the personal foul as Kevin Mackey, with palms up and extended, is asking why in the world the foul was called.
We're getting a couple players in foul trouble early, and Greg Lockhart now has two, but we've got Eddie Bryant and Pat Bianchik, who hasn't seen very much action, both on the bench with three.
Numerous fouls called when these two teams battled in Buffalo earlier in December. Both teams very physical, both teams press from one end of the floor to the other, and anytime you get that combination, the officials are going to have to blow the whistle. Warren Bradley with the loose carom. The Vikings still lead by 9, though. It's not a comfortable lead, but 9 is better than none.
You know, coming into the game, Warren had 71 rebounds to lead the team, and I checked last year's stats, and at this point, the leading rebounder last year was Bob Crawford, and he only had 67. So Warren is ahead of the pace.
Percy inside in traffic, couldn't buy the basket. And Mike Brown comes off with a rebound. Brown at 6'9", transfer.
The leading shot blocker in the history of the state of Delaware in high school. That's what his high school coach said about.
That's an important note. We better mark that down, don't you think?
That's right. But here's one of our leading keys in the history of Cleveland State.
Yeah, leading steel man, Sean Hood, with an easy basket. Hood with his first hoop of the night. And it's 31-20. Pressure is on. 1:17 left, and the clock is rolling here in the opening half of play. Michael Ray Jackson with a nice dish off. Bailey took it to the basket, got fouled by Sean Hood. And this will be tricky because Sean Hood and Warren Bradley both put their hands up specify that they fouled.
Somebody had to stop him because otherwise it would have been an easy basket.
Bailey will head to the free throw line with 9 points on the night. Well, let's see. I think both players ended up with it.
He had the baseline wide open. Well, we couldn't see from that angle, but maybe it's good that they called it on Sean as opposed to Warren, because, well, he can't even afford to lose Sean either, because we've got Eddie Bryant with three fouls.
Here's another look. Somebody forgot to play some defense down low. I think maybe both players got a piece of him.
Well, fortunately, Marvin Bailey only converted one of those free throws.
Vikings with a win tonight could tie their start from last year at 8-2. Sean Hood got inside, lost the basketball, picked it back up, and got called for traveling.
I disagree with that call. Sean had the ball knocked out of his hands before he picked it up again, but obviously they didn't see it.
Well, with that many bodies down low converging, sometimes you do miss that. But if that's the way it looked, the ball was slapped away, and by the time he picked it up, they called him for traveling.
The thing that makes that call somewhat questionable is, as we get an offensive foul from the other end, the thing that makes that call questionable is the position of the official when he called it.
Are you in favor of using three officials, Alan Davis, or two?
I think for this type of basketball, you definitely have to. The pace is much too fast for a lot of these officials, and with no disrespect to them, but they are grown men officiating a game that is played by younger men who are like racehorses.
Shot clock is now off as Sean Hood eyes the game clock at 20 seconds, and Sean is going to stand right at center circle until he decides it's time to run a play. Ramsey on the wing. The Mouse has it back. Penetrates, takes it inside. Oh, my!
What a move!
Loop-de-loop by McFadden, who now has 13, and Canisius will run out of time here and will not even get the ball to half court. Stellar move by the sophomore guard out of New York City. That brought the fans to their feet here at Woodland Gymnasium. They have been quiet from time to time, but I have a feeling they'll be more excited perhaps in the second half. Our halftime score here at Woodland Gymnasium, Cleveland State 33, Canisius 21. You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
Another day starts. The heart of the city never rests. It's a part of your life. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. Every morning never misses a beat. The heart
your day with the Plain Dealer. Call 344-4600 for home delivery.
Hi, I'm Ed Mullenix. Every car, every truck is on sale during our 6-day year-end sell down. It's a buyer's market at Mullenix Ford, east or west, with over 1,500 cars and trucks. Buy any new Ford and get a $300 to $600 cash rebate. It's our goal to reduce our inventory by about 300 units. And now is your last chance for a tax break. Take a test drive this week, and we'll give you a video tax guide just for shopping at Mullenix Ford, east or west.
Now, I just turned around for half a second, and boom, the whole thing went up.
Hottest day in the summer, and we end up loading that sucker twice.
Oh, yeah. Hey, you remember looking at old man Donovan's face?
After that, I never thought he'd bring out that keg like
that. That was good draft. Wasn't it?
I remember that beer.
Drinking Miller Genuine Draft will remind you of the best beer you've ever had, because it is genuine draft, cold-filtered for real draft smoothness. It's beer at its best.
Hey, how come Donovan never asked us back?
We're back at Woodland Gymnasium. The halftime score, Cleveland State 33, Canisius 21. And that matches the Vikings' biggest lead of the first 20 minutes of basketball. Alan Davis, a 12-point spread. It has not been easy, but Cleveland State has opened up, I wouldn't say a comfortable margin at this point, but it's always nice to be ahead by a dozen or so at halftime.
It definitely is, but you mentioned that it wasn't a comfortable margin. No lead is comfortable, I don't believe, against any opponent. You should never downplay that the fact that your opponent might be down, but against Canisius even more so, because they are a good team. They're a good team defensively, and so far what's happened is basically they've had steals and they've forced turnovers, but they haven't been able to convert.
The big story in the first half has been the outstanding play of Mouse McFadden. Mouse 6 of 8 from the field, including a three-pointer. He now has 13 points, leads all scorers at this stage, and he has really been a factor thus far in the first half of play, Alan.
Well, I think the most surprising thing is that Cleveland State has actually taken 2 3-point shots, and they've made both of them. And that's very uncharacteristic, because statistics show Cleveland State has only shot 17 three-pointers all season going into this game. Their opponents had shot 71 and converted 30. A little bit better percentage, and we're going to talk about three-point play to Coach Mackey coming up here at halftime.
Well, we've got to give some credit then to Clinton Ramsey, who hit the other three-point shot. So Ramsey and McFadden both with three-pointers. Well, coming up next after this message, Alan will speak with head coach Kevin Mackey on the Big Mackey Report.
Mackey.
Crossroads Lincoln Mercury, Ohio's largest Cougar dealer, is having a mammoth year-end tax savings sale. Buy or lease any of our newer used cars and you save two ways. Our prices are drastically reduced by year-end tax saving write-downs, and you still get the substantial sales tax deduction. Act now and let Uncle Sam help pay your way. See us and you'll see why, if a Crossroads sticker isn't on your car, you probably paid too much.
Out on the street, beat never stops. When dawn breaks, another day starts. The plain dealer, the heart of the city. The plain dealer, the heart of the city. The plain dealer, the heart of the city. It's part of your life.
Start your day with the plain dealer. Call 344-4600 for home delivery.
Mackey Report is brought to you by the McDonald's restaurants of Northeast Ohio.
Hi, everyone. I'm Alan Davis, and welcome again to another Big Mackey Report with the coach of the Cleveland State Vikings, Kevin Mackey. Kevin, after five long games on the road, I guess it felt good the other night to come back and win an easy one at home in the friendly confines of Woodland Gym.
Absolutely. You can't beat that home cooking. It's great to get back home, Alan.
But I'm sure that looking back at the five games you played on the road, you're very happy with that 4-1 record.
Well, if someone said you win 4 out of 5, I'd say, hey, let me mail it in. I don't want to play the games. Let me just take the 4 W's. It was very tough. The kids responded. They were just terrific.
Kevin, let's talk about one of the most controversial rules changes in college basketball this year, the 3-point field goal. Let's get, first of all, your feelings on it.
Alan, I don't like it. I think we had a great game, and I wish they just left it alone. I think the rules makers have to have a reason to be there and to do something. The coaches like the game the way it is, and I think, of course, the kids, anytime they can get more points, they're going to try for it. We've used it some. Eddie Bryan has hit some big shots for us. Kenny Robinson hit one the other night. The Mouse can hit them. But I don't like it. I like the game the way it was. Maybe that's a sign I'm getting old.
Obviously, though, because of the fact that you have not used it as much as your opposition, you must have some ideas as to when you're going to use it. When is that?
Well, I think if you're wide open and there's a young man who can shoot it. For instance, when we played St. Joseph's, St. Joseph's really took advantage of it. They went way up on us taking those long shots. They had some kids who could shoot it. We were doubling the ball, trapping the ball when it came over half court, leaving a person open, and that guy really burned us with those long shots. So we had to stop doing that and really get up in their face so they couldn't hit the shot. It was designed, Alan, to take away the rough play and the collapsing underneath the basket, and it has to a certain degree. I think if they moved it out a couple more feet, the coaches wouldn't have a problem with it. Right now, frankly, we don't know just what to do with it. My guys don't shoot it as a steady diet.
Okay, more from the coach of the Cleveland State Vikings, Kevin Mackey, after this message from McDonald's Restaurants of Northeast Ohio.
There are many defenses to stop an offensive attack. Bobby Knight lives by man-to-man D. There's a 2-3 zone, the box and one. But there's one attack there's no defense against, the Big Mac attack. And right now at McDonald's, you can get the Big Mac meal combo, which includes a Big Mac, medium Coke, and fries for just $1.99. Don't fight it. There's no defense against a Big Mac attack.
If your old car died this morning, it may have left you an inheritance.
Oh, really?
If you can drag it to Gene Norris Used Car Center, we'll give you $1,000 towards one that's alive and well. We've got over 100 in stock with good life expectancy. Surely one to fit your budget. So budget, get your wreck to Gene Norris Used Car Center and collect your $1,000 inheritance. Park it next to the 56 Edsel.
Transportation. Get the most out of it from the guy whose name is built into it, Gene Norris.
Back once again on the Big Mackey Report with the coach of the Cleveland State Vikings, and Kevin, picking up once again on the point of the three-point field goal and the cleaning up the play inside. You don't shoot the goal that often, so most teams tend defensively to pack it in the middle with you.
That's right. Most teams will play us the same way. Whether it's a man, it'll be a sagging man. If it's a zone, it'll be a sagging zone. Try to take the inside game away from us. We attack. We try to get in close to the basket. I believe in good high percentage shots, drawing the foul. I'm very proud of the fact last year we were plus 341 more free throws than our opponents. I think that shows you some discipline on offense, and the kids are taking good shots.
Well, now with the absence of Eric Mudd for the rest of the season, you're going to need some scoring from the outside.
Well, I don't know. Hershey Strong is coming on. Hershey's from Collinwood, a real good local youngster who has a good inside game, and he played very well in our last game the other night against Maryland Eastern Shore with 19 points. In fact, he was 7-for-7 from the floor. You can't get much better than 7-for-7. I think that Pat Vianchek's coming on. Ray Salters is tough inside. Ranzi can go inside. Plus, we'll take the open jumper. McFadden will do his thing. Ranzi will hit the open jumper. Eddie Bryant can hit it. And I want to keep the balance, but basically, we attack inside and go to the basket.
I'm sure you've got to be looking forward to a little bit of a break right now after tonight's game.
Absolutely. It'll be good. We'll have a break for the new year, and we'll come back the 12th, hopefully refreshed and ready to go.
And then, of course, there's conference play coming up not too far away.
That's right. The conference is going to be tough. Southwest had a great win. Southwest Missouri over Arkansas, and Illinois-Chicago beat Michigan State, so the conference is going to be better than ever this year.
And, of course, with the addition of Eldon Miller at Iowa, Northern Iowa, the league has a high profile.
Without a doubt. Eldon will get that program going. He's an outstanding coach, and they'll be very tough very soon.
Okay, Kevin, we'll talk to you once again at halftime of the Florida A&M game on January 12th. And if you have a question for Coach Mackey, you can write us here at Behind the Bench, 2720 Van Aken Boulevard, Cleveland, Ohio, 44120. If your question is used on the air, you'll receive a free T-shirt courtesy of McDonald's. Now let's go back courtside after this message from McDonald's.
There are many defenses to stop an offensive attack. Bobby Knight lives by man-to-man D. There's a 2-3 zone. The box and one. But there's one attack there's no defense against, the Big Mac attack. And right now at McDonald's, you can get the Big Mac meal combo, which includes a Big Mac, medium Coke, and fries for just $1.99. Don't fight it. There's no defense against a Big Mac attack.
Hi, I'm Ed Mullinix. Every car, every truck is on sale during our 6-day year-end sell down. It's a buyer's market at Mullinix Ford, east or west, with over 1,500 cars and trucks. Buy any new Ford and get a $300 to $600 cash rebate. It's our goal to reduce our inventory by about 300 units. And now is your last chance for a tax break. Take a test drive this week, and we'll give you a video tax guide just for shopping at Mullinix Ford, east or west.
Back at Whittling Gymnasium, halftime score is Cleveland State 33 and Canisius 21. Vikings leading by a dozen, and things looking pretty good here at halftime. Alan Davis, one thing that Cleveland State has done effectively here in the first 20 minutes of basketball is forced turnovers. Canisius with 17 turnovers in the first half of play.
That's right, to only seven for the Vikings, and even though they are being out-rebounded 17-10, I think the turnovers are key, and here I think we're going to see one of them. A steal by Kenny Robertson. Up and misses it, but Warren Bradley very alertly puts the tip in.
Vikings have generated some loose balls. There you see Elgin Womack with a beautiful block. Eddie Bryant takes it all the way, covers up, and banks it home.
Eddie Bryant's only 2 points of the first half. And I think we're going to see another one. No, we're not, I guess. Evidently, we're back here live at Woodling Gym. Okay, here it comes, and let's take a look at it.
Our producer-director, Jim Williams, would never steer us awry.
That's right, folks. There we go. All right, I think this is going to be that great steal by Eddie Bryant. No, it's not going to be one. It's Clinton Ramsey driving. And notice how he protects the ball with his body. Of course, he was ahead of the guy. He was slowing down, hoping to draw a foul on top of that, too, and maybe make a three-point play the conventional way.
Vikings have done an excellent job at pinching that basketball at about half court. Let's hope that trend continues in half number two. We'll be back with more basketball action. You're watching Cleveland State Basketball on 19.
On the next What a Country.
I got credit.
I don't leave home without it.
He discovers credit card.
You give people plastic and they give you stuff.
He discovers shopping.
Ooh. I spend so good, they send me more credit cards.
He discovers
the bill.
Credit card junkie.
Going crazy with credit cards.
I have plastic monkey on my back.
On What a Country.
Wednesdays at 7:30.
You feel a Big Mac attack coming on. Get over to McDonald's fast, because right now you can get a Big Mac, golden fries, and a medium Coca-Cola for just $1.99. Is that a great deal? You can get a Big Mac, fries, and a medium Coke for only $1.99. But hurry before it's all gone.
Crossroads Lincoln Mercury, Ohio's largest Cougar dealer, is having a mammoth year-end tax savings sale. Buy or lease any of our newer used cars and you save two ways. Our prices are drastically reduced by year-end tax saving write-downs, and you still get the substantial sales tax deduction. Act now and let Uncle Sam help pay your way. See us and you'll see why, if a Crossroads sticker isn't on your car, you probably paid too much.
The Big Ten's Minnesota confronts Tennessee of the Southeastern Conference in the Liberty Bowl, here over the Raycom Sports Network. The Golden Gophers have shown upset ability all season long with their thrilling comeback against Michigan. Quarterback Ricky Foggy leads the attack on the Volunteers, the 1986 Sugar Bowl champions, after upsetting number one ranked Miami in postseason play last year. All the exciting Liberty Bowl action is here.
Live on 19, Monday at 8.
Welcome back, Denny Schreiner and Alan Davis here with halftime statistics, Alan.
You look at that. That's surprising. Cleveland State has outshot Canisius 2-1 from the field, 28 field goals to 14. That is very surprising. And, of course, even more surprising is the fact that Canisius has gone to the line more often than the Vikings have. But it's going to be interesting. Pat Vianchik is starting the second half, and so is Eddie Bryant. Both of them have three personal fouls, and they've got to play a little bit more carefully than they did the first half.
Vikings will run it back the other direction. Mouse McFadden leading all scorers with 13 points. Marvin Bailey with 10. Top point getter for Canisius. 33-21. Vikes by a dozen. Would love dearly to notch victory number 8 on the season. Ramsey banks it off the left side of the glass. Let him stand and plant from that area, and he'll make about 8 out of 10.
9 points for Quentin so far.
Quentin with a steal. Spin move inside. Oh, banked it home, and it was a beauty. Ramsey with the 11.
You know, maybe this is Clinton's half to get hot. Kenny McFadden was hot the first half, and maybe it'll be the Clinton Ramsey show second half.
It's running stun time right now, and Canisius is stunned to open up the second half as the Vikings, in the form of Clinton Ramsey, scored 2 buckets in a hurry in less than 1 minute. And of course, we'd like to welcome all of our Cleveland State basketball fans on Score, the national network. Pass down low, batted out of bounds by the very quick hands of senior forward number 44, Clinton Ramsey, and he's put together a highlight film here in the first 60 seconds.
Very alert play, too, because Marvin Bailey was wide open.
Vikings with a 16-point lead. Heinel, turnaround jumper won't go. Ball tapped out of bounds by Pat Vianchik, and Vianchik could have very easily been whistled for personal number 4.
I'll tell you, I breathed a sigh of relief when they just called the ball out of bounds to Canisius, because I definitely thought that Vianchik had the foul.
Davis, baseline left, off the rim, no good. Heinold with a rebound, has it stripped away, and Eddie Bryant's on the move. Ramsey feeds off to his counterpart, Mouse McFadden. McFadden now 7 for 9 from the field, and we've got a whistle and a foul in the backcourt, and it's charging.
Brian Smith gets the call, and right away, Nick Makarczyk wants to talk it over.
And quiet the crowd if he possibly can. 18 minutes, 30 seconds remaining here in the basketball game. And the Vikings have now opened up an 18-point lead. And here you're going to see Davis fights through. I'm not so sure that
was a little
bit
of Hollywood there,
foul,
and I think the officials fell for it.
That's what you have to work on.
Yeah, I have to say that they have done an admirable job today. They haven't fallen for some of the acting that's gone on, and of course that's part of college basketball today. The guys are going to do it, see if they can get away with it. That time, I think Clinton did a little bit. Other times he doesn't.
And don't forget, there's more sports action coming your way this weekend on 19. Tomorrow night, live at 8 p.m., Minnesota meets Tennessee in the Liberty Bowl. And then on Wednesday, the college football action continues at 8 o'clock with the All-American Bowl. College Bowl action Monday and Wednesday at 8 o'clock on 19. And of course, we're sports, and we're yours.
Followed by the Cereal Bowl and...
And
every
the,
other bowl. Like,
how about the Tidy Bowl?
That's,
have they played that yet?
I don't think so. Oh. Hey, by the way, while we have the chance, let us congratulate the CSU women for their first victory of the season last night, 66-59 over Rhode Island.
The Antic shot partially blocked, and Heinold comes down with the loose ball. Fans wanted a foul, but no call. Nick Makarczyk calling out the play. The fans want some fast-paced action. Golden Griffins at this point trying to slow it down. Heinold in the paint, turnaround jumper, banks at home, shot is good, whistle and a foul, and Warren Bradley, I have a feeling, will pick up the personal.
And you know, our sports information director here at Cleveland State, Merle Levin, just came in and gave me an amazing stat as we watch this basket by Chris Heinold. Definitely a foul by Warren Bradley. That is the first basket they scored since 10 minutes of the first half, since the 10-minute mark.
Boy, they've got to be parched at this point. That's a long drought.
Well, Heinold just put 3 points on the board for them.
And Chris Heinold bats the ball away, a long pass from Eddie Bryant. 39-24, Vikings by 15 and in control here. Mouse McFadden thought about the three. And then thought again, considering he was standing in front of Kevin Mackey.
They were 2 for 3 in the first half. Kenny Robertson marred what might have been a perfect performance. He missed his attempt. So the Vikings were 2 out of 3.
Long skip pass to Biancic, takes baseline, shoots the running one-hander, and he is fouled in the process by Jeff Taggart. Taggart's first personal foul. And Biancic really has had a tough time getting untracked here this evening. He picked up 3 personal fouls before the doors closed here at Woodling Gymnasium.
What did you call that, a skip pass? That looked more like one of those bombs that Pat Ryan was throwing today against the Kansas City Chiefs.
Yeah, unfortunately, the Jets got stoked up a little bit. Now they'll come to the lakefront next Saturday afternoon, the Browns and the Jets. What do you think?
I like our chances.
Yeah, I'm still not convinced that the Jets have the defense to stop Cleveland.
Biancic gets in the scorebook now for the first time today.
17-point bulge. Cleveland State in command at this point. But there's a long way to go. 17 and a half minutes left. Fans used to seeing their Vikings score 100 points at home. Don't think that'll be the case here this evening.
Well, they had 99 versus Maryland Eastern Shore, and there's a steal by McFadden.
Mouse at the line in traffic, has it stripped, no foul, and they'll come back the other way. Davis inside, shot nearly blocked, but a beautiful, beautiful flip shot by Davis. Or make that Brian Smith, I should say.
Well,
right over the top of Warren Bradley.
I don't know if you were giving me credit for that basket or not.
I know one thing. That was a prayer, but it went in. Bradley, high off the floor, couldn't come up with a block.
Quentin Ramsey now with 6 points this half, 13 for the game.
Quentin scored 16 against Canisius in the first go-around earlier this year.
I overheard Coach Nick McCarchick say when Ramsey took that shot, that's where we don't match. So evidently there's a defensive breakdown.
Well, they're playing some matchup zone. Somebody better find the seam, because if you let Ramsey stand there and shoot all night long, you're in big trouble.
Good effort by Pat Bianchik, but just couldn't quite come up with the basketball.
Might mention the fact that Quentin Ramsey, I think, has now made six shots in a row. Boy, is he on a streak at this moment.
Including a three-pointer.
Now, you won't see many of those three-pointers if you're a Cleveland State fan. But there's no need to. What the heck? If you can get a layup for some pressure defense to turn some offense, you don't have to shoot from out there.
I think that Canisius is going to have to start taking a few of those if it gets any further into the game and they're still down by as many points as they are.
Jeff Taggart, with his first 2 points of the night, hit a bank shot off the left side. 15-point advantage, 43-28. Ramsey right wing. And Jeff Taggart cannot believe it. He looks at Murph Shapiro and says, Murph, all I did was hand check him, and I got whistled for the foul. And we've got an officials timeout. So with 15:39 left in this one, the Vikings lead by 15. And you're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
Hi, I'm Ed Mullenix. Every car, every truck is on sale during our 6-day year-end sell down. It's a buyer's market at Mullinex Ford, east or west, with over 1,500 cars and trucks. Buy any new Ford and get a $300 to $600 cash rebate. It's our goal to reduce our inventory by about 300 units. And now is your last chance for a tax break. Take a test drive this week, and we'll give you a video tax guide just for shopping at Mullinex Ford, east or west.
Tuesday on Cinema 19 Prime Time.
It's the most beautiful car in the whole world.
The tales this car's backseat could tell.
Hey, this is the one I want.
What?
This one with the telephone thing. It's cute. Oh.
In love. Take a spin in the yellow Rolls Royce. Tuesday at 8 on 19.
Welcome back. Jenny Schreiner along with Alan Davis. And our score with 15:39 left is Cleveland State 43 and Canisius 28. And there you see it. If you have a question for Coach Kevin Mackey, write to Behind the Bench, 2720 Van Aken Boulevard, Cleveland, Ohio, 44120.
Please write soon. I'm running out of questions to ask the coach. I can't make them up anymore.
You mean Santa didn't give you a couple? McFadden's jumper won't go. Rebound foul inside. And Warren Bradley, I think, is the guilty party.
Well, he called that on Clinton Ramsey. That's his first. Boy, I'd like to see that one again, because at least from this angle, we saw Clinton, or rather Warren Bradley, commit a personal, but maybe, there we go. Okay, he reached in. And that's where he got caught, with his hands in a cookie jar.
There's a steal for Sean Hood. It's a race to the backboard. Inside reverse layup. And that's what Sean Hood does best. Steal it and take it the length of the floor.
Great move by Sean, and he almost drew a personal with it.
Sean Hood now with four on the night, and it's 45-28.
And Sean Hood only scored five in the first meeting between these two clubs.
Marvin Bailey, who was a force in the first half, hasn't done much in the second half. Another turnover. The mouse takes it inside. Shot is blocked. Whistle and called. Goaltending on Michael Ray Jackson or Marvin Bailey. I don't know. I thought it was Jackson myself.
Well, let's take a look at it and see. Yeah, it was Jackson. Bailey's, well, I don't know.
No, it wasn't. Bailey came in late and blocked it.
As we see Marvin getting set to leap there. Well, he comes and makes up for it on the other end here with his basket.
And in a big way, Bailey now with a dozen two-hand slam. Elgin Womack seeing his first playing time in half number two. Tick's senior center had 1 point in the first half. Mouse McFadden thought that Salters was going to go baseline and bounce past it right out of bounds. And Kenny McFadden will sit down, and Kenny Robertson, number 21 out of Barberton, Ohio, will check in.
You know, seeing that slam by Bailey reminds me that Ray Salters told me before the game, that's one thing he wants to do with tonight's game. He wants to dunk one.
Terrific play that time by Michael Ray Jackson, who penetrated, passed off, and Heinl just simply couldn't find the handle on the fast break, and Cleveland State will bring it back the other way. Vikings by 17.
There you saw the contrasting view of the two coaches. Great feed by Robertson.
Ray Salters, the recipient of a beautiful assist. Salters now with eight. And this one has turned into a run-and-stun affair. The Golden Griffins about ready to head back into hibernation.
I wonder where you picked up that phrase, run-and-stun. Have you ever heard that before?
Sure, I watched the videotape that Coach Kevin Mackey put out. Tough play inside,
yes.
And Bailey gets called for traveling. What an athletic move to pull down the lob pass, but he couldn't plant his feet in time.
Well, he had three white shirts around him, and I'm sure that made him think twice about it.
That's one thing. If you do post up low on Cleveland State, you're going to find some traffic in a hurry. Boy, yeah. Terrific play just to get to the basketball.
Percy Strong had a finger on that, too.
Half-court trap now being employed by Canisius.
Vikings are making some interesting passes tonight. A lot of lobs.
Traveling?
Either that or he touched the baseline.
One of the two, but I have a feeling that he did step across the baseline.
Well, that's Hersey's bread and butter move, that baseline drive, as you see Ray Salters take a steal here.
Salters in the secondary, took the pass. Oh, my, what a wild scramble down low. Shot! Amongst the tall trees, how in the world did he ever get that shot off?
And he releases it from so low, such a low point, that you wonder why it doesn't get blocked more often than it does.
Boy, he cleared out a little room inside and shot that one from the hip. Sean now with six. Oh, what a tough shot inside. 51-30. Vikings in total control now. Whistling a foul down low. Hersey Strong caught bumping Marvin Bailey that time. And three fresh reserves check in. Pat Vianchek, Warren Bradley, and Eddie Bryant.
And you know, Sean Hood, who's going to the bench right now, has become probably our most effective post-up player at 5'7", the smallest guy on the team.
Hey, you know, Spud Webb is no small potato.
That's true.
He'll take you in there post-up and dunk on you.
Great steal there by Warren. Good heads-up play, but unfortunately they can't convert.
Eddie Bryant with the Daryl LaMonica special there that Vianchek couldn't find the handle on. This has turned into a helter-skelter affair, which is exactly what the Vikings love. They feast on this kind of a basketball game.
And right now with a 21-point lead.
Warren Bradley with a near save right in front of the Canisius bench. But not quite in time. Nick Makarchuk trying to get that basketball down low, if at all possible, but the Vikings doing a beautiful job of collapsing inside.
The Golden Griffins have not played well on the road this season. First two road losses, they lost by a total margin of 57 points.
Those losses coming at the hands of Syracuse and also Cornell.
No two lollipops. They're down 21 right now. I think that loss to Cornell was, what, 22 points?
I think it was 28, and Syracuse beat them by 20. Boy, power move inside by big Mike Brown. That's Brown's first hoop of the evening.
And this is the guy that they're looking to give him that big that help in the middle. And so far this season, he's only averaging 2 points a game.
Vianchek tried to dish off to Kenny Robertson, who had the ball slapped out of his hands, and they're going to rule that Canisius will get the basketball as Clint Ramsey and the Mouse McFadden check in. We've got an official time on the floor, though. With 11 minutes and 37 seconds remaining here in the basketball game, Cleveland State on top by a bundle. They lead Canisius 51-32, and you're watching Cleveland State basketball action on 19.
Jim Marsh Ford, the dealer that gives you more. Escorts, the best-selling car in the world. Taurus, super selection available. Mustang, sporty and all new for 87. Crown Victoria, a full-size car with luxury and comfort. Thunderbird, all new style and grace. People drive from all over Northern Ohio to Jim Marsh Ford, 328 11 Aurora Road in Solon. Call 248-1550. Low overhead means low prices.
It started out as a party, but turned into a case of the missing case.
Groovy shindig.
What do we have, Glitch?
It's okay, doll.
No, it's not. There's a case of Miller Lite missing.
Who took it?
Somebody in this room.
Rodney!
Hey, guys, take it easy, will you?
Why'd you do it, Rodney? Cause light tastes great?
Yeah!
Or cause light's less filled?
Yeah!
I didn't do it. Well, I'm not even Rodney.
You! I thought it was a costume party. Great mask, huh?
But if he didn't do it, who did?
They'll never figure out who took that case.
Oh, Mickey, you did!
Not exactly.
Hiya, doll.
Gotcha.
Well, I'm glad we didn't go dancing.
It's no mystery that there's only one light beer, Miller Lite.
We're back at Woodland Gymnasium. Denny Schreiner along with Alan Davis. Vikings comfortably ahead at 51-32 with 11:20 left in this one.
Well, still plenty of time, although this team has not played well on the road, as we alluded to, and they don't look like they're a good comeback team, especially when they're this far behind. They really haven't taken that many shots. We showed the statistics at halftime. Cleveland State had outshot them 2-1.
Kenny McFadden with some Harlem Globetrotter-like moves. Kept the ball alive, took it down the floor, got it to Ramsey, who was fouled in the process of shooting by Michael Ray Jackson, and Ramsey will shoot a pair.
And that's three on Michael Ray, as you see the showmanship of Kenny McFadden, the pass to Clinton Ramsey, and there was nothing that Michael Ray Jackson could do but foul him.
What a marvelous ball handler. Really is a magician with the basketball and prides himself in those creative moves. Clinton Ramsey with 14 on the evening. And make it 15 as the senior forward shows that soft shooting touch.
He's 2-for-2 from the free throw line tonight. And by the way, 14 more free throw attempts, and he will break the career record for most attempts in a college career at Cleveland State.
Ramsey with a helter-skelter shot. Fallaway jumper got fouled by Michael Ray Jackson again. And so ditto that foul of just about 20 seconds ago. Michael Ray with four personal fouls, one more, and he'll be back on the bus. Ramsey could make a living at the free shot line, too.
Saw him here 2 years ago, was a perfect 16 of 16 from the free throw line against Akron University. It's 3 of 3 tonight.
And speaking of 16, that's how many points this senior forward has. Oh.
We jinxed him.
It never fails. That's it. That's the last time this year on 19 that you and I are going to talk about what great free throw shooters people are. All right? Remind me about that the next time we get in.
Well, why doesn't it work in reverse when we talk about how bad they shoot free throws? They never come up with a good performance, but they come up with some great steals like that one.
Mouse McFadden to the basket. Oh, he blew the bunny down low. It was a tough try on the reverse layup, but I know he's upset with himself. Now it's a 2-on-1 break the other way. Bounce pass. Heinold takes it in. Reverse layup, no good. He'll put it back up off the glass and finally score down low. Well, persistence pays off.
And Warren Bradley got away with one there because he was all over Heinold, and evidently neither one of the officials saw it.
Warren Bradley with a turnaround spin move that didn't hit anything but Taggart's hands on the way back down.
I'll tell you one thing. When Warren Bradley learns to make that shot, he is going to be a force to be reckoned with.
Clinton Ramsey called for a bit of a reach foul. Obviously a sign of fatigue. When you don't move those feet defensively, normally it's because you're tired.
Well, that's why Kevin Mackey plays 10 men.
Feet kind of forgot to move.
Into him.
Yeah, he did. Percy Strong back in the lineup. Pat Vianchik sits down, grabs a towel and a cool glass of water. Now
okay.
A whistle and a foul down low.
He didn't get away with that one that time. But Warren Bradley has been playing great defense against Heinold, who is a little, actually, they match up pretty evenly.
54-34, Vikings by 20, under 10 minutes to play. Baseline jumper no good. Warren Bradley skied for that rebound.
That's what he does best. He's aggressive on the boards. And Hersey Strong loses the pass.
Another beautiful full court pass by number 5, Eddie Bryant. And Hersey couldn't hang on to that one. Bryant's been going deep. Hasn't come up with any two-pointers yet, though. Long pass, and now there's a steal. The mouse is on the move, and he'll take it up and just softly lay it on the glass. And now the mouse has 19, and he leads all point getters.
Notice how this time he slowed down, and he made sure that he had the ball. Good slap steal by Eddie Bryant.
Ramsey to the mouse, shot is blocked. Goal tending is called on Chris Heinold, and now the mouse has 21, and Canisius wants a timeout. You can't really blame them. The run and stun crew is really taking over here as they lead by 24.
Okay, here's the pass to Kenny McFadden, and definitely that ball was up above the rim, and Heinold showing good leaping ability. He has a 29-inch vertical leap, but this time he touched it and there was really nothing he could do about it. That ball was going in.
Great pass that time by Ramsey. Did you check him out that time, Alan Davis?
Sure.
Did not look at the player he was going to give the ball to, and just until the last instant. That's how you fool those defensive people.
And you draw the defensive man over to you.
And don't forget, a television event returns to 19 in January, beginning Monday, January 19th at 8 p.m. For 5 consecutive nights, 19 will present Irwin Shaw's Rich Man, Poor Man. Peter Strauss and Nick Nolte star in the drama that started the mini-series concept, Rich Man, Poor Man, beginning January 19th. On 19, and I'll be the rich man and you can be the poor man, Alan.
Well, I'll tell you right now, I think that Nick McCarchick is playing the role of poor man in this drama that we are seeing unfold before our eyes. There's not really much drama to do, you know, not much drama to it.
How about a miniseries? You and I will write it on Cleveland State basketball. What do you think?
Oh, definitely.
I'm sure Kevin Mackey would love to star in that, and the Mouse McFadden, of course, loves the lights.
We'll call it Viking. Or Day of the Viking.
Good. Right, well, now it's the Night of the Vikings. And there's
right.
Another steal. Ramsey with a basketball. Inside, running one-hander. Ramsey with 18. And boy, has he been a factor in this one tonight. Another pass, another basket. Ramsey with 20. They're making it look easy right now. And Canisius is a pretty doggone good basketball team, but they've been embarrassed here this evening.
Well, they haven't played well on the road. It's a little different than when you're at home.
Another steal, another basket, another foul, and another free throw for Ken McFadden. McFadden now with 23. McFadden and Ramsey have simply taken over the basketball game.
And here it is. And a great, great shot, and he's going to go for the three.
Kenny McFadden shooting just a fraction better than 50% from the field on the season. And through 9 games, he's at 73.8 from the free throw line. Trying to convert and make it a 3-point play, and he doesn't. Oh, in and out. 64-34, and Cleveland State has blitzed Canisius here in the second half. It was a 12-point basketball game at the intermission. Oh, my. Power move to the basket by Grady Minnick, who got the stuff. And also picked up the personal foul, personal call on number 25, I believe. That's Greg Lockhart.
Well, let's take a look and see. I believe it was Hersey Strong. It was pretty obvious that time.
You're right. Oh, there's the plant, the jump, and the jam.
And Grady Minnick now with 4 points. Minnick has five. He's 3 for 4 from the line, and we mentioned he didn't play in the first game against Cleveland State, recovering from a broken ankle. He's had a share of bad luck.
Oh, it was out of dandy of a move down low by Hersey Strong, who has been pretty quiet here this evening. That's his first 2 points of the night. Great spin move inside and use the left hand. Bailey with a pull-up jumper now has 14 on the night, and it's 66-39. This one, for all intents and purposes, is in the hands of Cleveland State.
But you know, now Canisius is trying to come back. They're getting a little more aggressive on defense, and they're also taking more shots, and they should have done that a long time ago. I'm surprised that they haven't done that before now. Now it might be a little bit too late.
Jump ball is the call down low. Rule of possession will keep the basketball at this end of the floor. Canisius will have it. We've got a timeout on the floor. And so with 7 minutes and 30 seconds left in this one, Cleveland State is off and running. The run and stun crew in full gear right now. And you're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
Throughout the states, Toyotathon 87 rolls on. Now's the time to save hundreds of dollars. This is the last week sales tax is deductible. Trish?
There's a big crowd here, and they're making great deals.
That's the price? Happy New Year!
And they're open late to make more Toyotathon deals to smash last year's sales record.
Immediate delivery on every Toyota in stock.
Get the right deal right now. Toyotathon 87's going strong at your Toyota dealers. Who could ask for anything more?
The Big Ten's Minnesota confronts Tennessee of the Southeastern Conference in the Liberty Bowl, here over the Raycom Sports Network. The Golden Gophers have shown upset ability all season long with their thrilling comeback against Michigan. Quarterback Ricky Foggy leads the attack on the Volunteers, the 1986 Sugar Bowl champions, after upsetting number one ranked Miami in postseason play last year. All the exciting Liberty Bowl action is here. Live on 19, Monday at 8.
Canisius with a basketball, and the jumper inside is good by Jamel Mosley. That's his first 2 points of the night, and Ray Salters beats everybody down the floor. Gets a beautiful pass, and Salters now on the night with 10. Boy, it's tough. You work real hard to get a basket. Somebody throws it the length of the floor, and the other team gets a layup. That's demoralizing.
Well, at least more people are scoring now. You see more of them going to the basket.
Near steal that time by the talented Brian Smith. Thus far this evening, with 6:57 left, Allen Davis, Cleveland State has forced Canisius into 35 turnovers. Mouse McFadden with 8 steals thus far this evening. The Mouse leads the ball club in that department now with 34 on the season, and he's been turning them into two-pointers as well.
And he had 4 steals against Canisius up there in Buffalo the first time these two teams met. So evidently he likes to feast on Canisius passing.
Hersey Strong with a very, very quick move to the baseline. And Grady Minnick gets whistled for the personal foul. Hersey, probably the best in the business in Northeastern Ohio at head and shoulder faking and taking the ball to the basket via the baseline.
Well, I'll go one better, and that's a fellow that played here last year, now playing with the Golden State Warriors, Clinton Smith. And evidently Hersey, during his redshirt year last year, sat and watched Clinton Smith do that very well so often. He had the most explosive first step on anybody that I ever saw.
I'm sure George Karl saw it more than once as well, and he was the gentleman who drafted Clinton Smith. And he is playing some for Golden State.
That's right.
Nice give and go inside, and the bucket is good by Minnick, who hammered Hersey Strong in the process. 68-45. Cleveland State with 6:12 remaining here. Vikings in a position to win their 5th straight. Ray Salters in the stack extended himself and got, what, 2 or 3 more yards? Did he come close to the first down? My, my, my. He is a strong player, too. I mean, you try and stop him and you've got some serious problems.
Boy, he really had a crowd in there that he had to work through.
Geez, he's only triple teamed here. I wonder why he didn't get the shot off.
Look at it better from this angle. Look at that. 3 guys around him. He's still going to go up at it. Minnick had a hand on the ball, but he also had a hand on the arm.
Free shot, no good. Oh, my, what a mad scramble that was.
First and 10.
Yeah, pass was incomplete. Man, oh, man. Players are flying all over the place, but that's Cleveland State basketball, believe me. Vikings not afraid to go to the floor. Beautiful save that time by Chris Heinold, who ricocheted off the ankle of Greg Lockhart.
Very alert play by Heinold. Almost stolen. Ho, ho.
Well, that one was worth the price of admission. The jam by Bailey, that's his second high percentage jam of the evening. Heinold at 6'8 with a dandy of a pass down low.
Unfortunately for Canisius, though, it only cuts the lead down to 21 points.
And with 5:20 left, the clock is beginning to become an enemy of Canisius. When you play on the road, that clock just seems to lag and lag. Ray Salters, spin move, that's his favorite move. That's his forte, spin move and bank it off the glass. And now Big Ray has a dozen on the evening.
Rambro. You know, he has his own cheering section. When he came out to warm up before the game, he had some kids up in the stands yelling, Rambro, Rambro.
And he comes up with a rebound. It's 2-on-1. Robertson bounce pass back to Sean Hood with a basket.
Eight points for Sean Hood, six of them this half.
Brian Smith with a basket down low. Lockhart gets whistled for the foul, and Greg Lockhart can't believe it. But Brian Smith now has seven. He'll head to the line and look for his eighth point of the night.
Nice pass by Heinold. I would think Heinold has to lead the club in assists, at least tonight. Good all-around player. Leads them in scoring, leads them in rebounding. No wonder he was second team all ECAC North Atlantic last year.
72-50. Biggest lead of the night was 30 points.
And playing Heinold is somewhat slightly out of position tonight. He's been playing forward. Now he's starting at center.
Warren Bradley committed just a little bit early that time. Warren gets up off the floor just a touch disgruntled, but nevertheless gets called for a personal foul. Warren, a very aggressive player. He doesn't leave any of it in the locker room.
But he's having a very frustrating night tonight. He's only got 2 points and a couple shots that he felt should have gone in, didn't go in, and that tends to add to the frustration level.
And watch that left arm. Yep, inside. Well, I'll tell you what, he might have gotten fouled from behind.
I'll take another look at it and let the fans judge for themselves. No, you might be right on that one.
I'm glad I'm not an official. That's all I can say.
They do have a tough job.
Taggart has it tipped away, and the Vikings are on the move. Vianchek, oh, he converts it. Oh, my. What a beautiful pass by Eddie Bryant. And Vianchek with four. That was as pretty as a picture.
And did you notice who started it all? Kenny Robertson was the one that tipped it away on the defensive end.
He could be jailed for grand theft larceny. I tell you, he's amazing.
Well,
now a move inside. Vianchek clears it and then airs it out.
It sounds like a cliche, but he makes things happen. And look at that. He almost made something happen there.
Kenny Robertson and Eddie Bryant were trying to hook up on the hook and ladder, the old alley-oop and jam, and Kenny got sort of boxed out inside. But he came up with the basketball, and then the got fouled. You know what the other guys call him on the team, don't you? His nickname. Call him Superman.
That's right.
If you would have seen the play he came up with the other night against Maryland Eastern Shore, it was unbelievable. He blocked a shot at the defensive end of the floor, knocked it off the backboard, fell down, the ball ricocheted out near half court. He got up, ran, picked the ball up, beat everybody down the floor, and then jammed it, and the place went crazy.
Unfortunately, he is less than super from the free throw line. Came into the game shooting 28%. And he just went 0-for-1.
Well, nobody's perfect.
Right now is scoreless in the game, but he definitely makes his presence felt on the floor.
Nice move inside by Jamel Mosley. Mosley now with four, and it's 74-52. Everybody is sticking around here. Sellout crowd this evening at Woodling Gymnasium. 3,048 on hand tonight. Vianchek down low with a basket, and he is fouled by Marvin Bailey from behind. Pat Vianchik, a 6'5", 205-pound senior. Shooting 51% from the floor on the season, about 65 from the free throw line. He's a better free throw shooter than that.
Making his fifth start tonight.
Pat now with 7 on the evening, and we have an officials timeout here at Woodling Gymnasium with 3:15 left here on the campus of Cleveland State University. The Vikings are ahead and in control, and you are watching Cleveland State basketball on 19.
Your Lincoln Mercury Mercour dealers have a cure for the wintertime blues. The sure-footed front-wheel drive Mercury Topaz. Right now, you can lease one through Ford Credit's red carpet lease plan for about $189 per month. This Topaz comes equipped with air conditioning, AM-FM stereo cassette and rear window defroster, plus tilt steering wheel, premium sound package, and more. Hurry in and lease a Mercury Topaz for about $189 per month with a red carpet lease from Ford Credit. See your Lincoln Mercury Mercour dealer today.
Ah, draft beer. It's always been the smoothest, freshest beer around, poured straight from the tap. And now, there's a true draft beer in a bottle. Miller Genuine Draft. It's not heat pasteurized like most bottled beers. It's cold filtered for real draft smoothness. Ask for Miller Genuine Draft, the Miller with the black label. It's beer at its best.
You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19. This telecast is presented by the authority of Cleveland State University. It is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Cleveland State or WOIO Television is strictly prohibited. Golden Griffins in all sorts of trouble here at Woodling Gymnasium this evening.
And you know, for the benefit of those fans who may be watching us nationally on the Sport Cable Network, you notice one thing, that no matter how big a lead the Cleveland State Vikings have, they never take the press off. Sometimes they've been criticized for it because against lesser teams like Clarion State, they scored 135 points here, and one of the local columnists came out criticizing them because they never took the press off. But that is the way Kevin Mackey plays. 10 men at least are going to see action. 11 have seen action tonight, and they're always going to be pressing. That's why you play so many guys.
Marvin Daly with 18, and he is the top point producer for the Golden Griffins of Canisius here this evening.
And only came into the game averaging 6.2.
Ramsey inside with a tough shot. Rebound kicked out to Chris Heinold. Number 50 takes it inside. Running one-hander, no good. And Vianchik. If Pat is the guilty party, I unofficially have him for 5 on the night. But let's wait.
Well, you're right. Well, I thought that Eddie Bryant had gotten him first of all, but there it is. And definitely a slap on the wrist by Pat Vianchik, who fouls out with 7 points on the night, all 7 coming in the second half.
Pat will never be cheated when he comes out to play. He gives you 115% each and every basketball game. Boy, it's about time for us to start thinking about that Miller Viking of the Game Award. I don't know, Mouse McFadden started so quickly, and he really got the Vikings off and running with 13 first-half points. He has 23 on the night. But, boy, a case could be made for Clinton Ramsey as well, who has 20.
I would be leaning toward Mouse McFadden, though, because of the 8 steals. He has certainly created a lot of offense. He hasn't scored the points, but he's always given them off to somebody else.
Well, we'll leave everybody in suspense, and we'll wait until after the game to decide. McFadden with a bit of a force that time, though. Now it's 3-on-1. Heinold with a tough pass that Bailey can't hang on to, but the Mouse back quickly on defense slapped it out of bounds.
And that's one of the reasons that I would be leaning towards McFadden.
There's a block by Kenny Robertson. Well, he closes like a professional defensive back, doesn't he?
The little man is amazing.
Yeah, pump fake by Mosley that time, who didn't want to shoot it back at Robertson. Kenny Robertson comes down with a basketball. You know, he has the innate ability, when the ball goes up in the air, to go and get it, regardless of who he's jumping against. And that's something you just can't teach, Alan Davis. That's just intuition and the ability to get up there faster than everybody else.
He also has the speed to go along with that leaping ability. And I know that in high school, he did go down to the state as a track man. He ran a 49-second 400 meter. And I know that the track coach here at Cleveland State, Dave Berger, has got to be drooling, wondering, what are you going to do after basketball season's over, son?
I think he has the ability to play two sports. No question about that. Made the first, missed the second. And we're under 2 minutes to go now. Heinold with a bank shot. And the basket is no good. Chris pleading his case, but it's fallen on deaf ears.
If you think he's pleading his case, Nick Makarczyk, just standing in front of us, is pleading it even more strongly.
And, of course, the next broadcast, as far as Cleveland State basketball on 19 is concerned, will be coming your way on January 12th, 1987 at 8 p.m. And the Vikings will take on the Rattlers of Florida A&M right here at Whittling Gymnasium. Have to bring the snake bite kit.
They have a busy week that week. They also play against Bowling Green that following Thursday, and then open up MQA conference play.
78-57. This one's pretty much out of the wood, as they say. Under 2 minutes to play. Nice move inside. Hersey Strong turnaround. Uh-oh, jam try by Bradley. No good, and he grabbed the rim. Technical foul for grasping as well.
Now, wait a minute.
Murph Shapiro making the call.
Well, I'll tell you, if we have that on replay, I'd like to see that again, because I don't really think that Warren Bradley did anything out of the ordinary. All right, let's take a look at it again. Now watch. I think he was just grabbing the rim to protect himself.
Well, the rule states that if you're doing that, it's not a technical foul. See it one more time. Yeah. Tough one to call.
It's a tough one to call.
Yeah, I think maybe the officials had the correct call there.
I think the best call in a situation like that is no call at all, because the game is out of hand. I don't think that one more point is going to make any difference as far as Canisius is concerned.
Warren Bradley high for the rebound, and he was fouled on the way back down by Marvin Bailey. Well, what do you think? Mouse McFadden tonight? Another Viking of the game?
Well, we've already given it to Clint Ramsey once, so I think that it's only fair that we spread it around a little bit.
Okay. Good idea. Warren Bradley with a free throw that rattles around and then finally drops through. Well, I have a feeling that if you'd have told Kevin Mackey before the season started, especially with what happened to Eric Mudd, that he was going to be 8-2 when he left 1986, he'd have kind of looked at you with that smile and said, geez, I'd love to be in that position.
I couldn't agree with you more.
I think he's tickled to death at this point. And both losses were very close losses. Uh-oh, there's a miscue. And on the way to the basket, it's a hack fest. Hersey Strong and also Miles McFadden with about a half each of Marvin Bailey. Regardless of who gets the personal foul, Bailey is going to be hurting in the morning.
A little bit too much exuberance here on the part of Hersey Strong. He went up for the ball, but came on down with the arm over the arm of Marvin Bailey as Warren Bradley takes a seat.
Bailey with an excellent performance this evening as that one rims in and out. Marvin Bailey with 18 points on the night.
You know, you talk about that 8-2 record for Cleveland State, and you go back to that Akron game. You and I saw that one in person, and you think, boy, if only.
Anthony Gay checks in to the Cleveland State lineup and doesn't waste any time at launching a two-pointer off the glass. Gay with his first basket of the night, and it's 82-59.
You know, here's a case of a guy who is very talented, but just is in that unfortunate situation of being at a school with four very good guards who have experience over him. And right now, it's very difficult to find Anthony Gay some playing time, and I know it's got to be very frustrating for him, because his duty is going to be very limited this year.
Jamel Mosley with a nice move to the foul line, got the jumper off. The shot went awry, and there's a whistle and a foul down low. Chris Einold, I think, got called for trying to grab himself a little extra position. What are you getting back to that point about Akron when you talked about the fact that we were there?
If they had made one more free throw in regulation, you know, they only shot 52% from the free throw line, 13 of 25. One more or two more free throws in regulation, that game would have never gone into overtime. And their record very easily right now could have been 9-1.
And when you consider the fact that Akron is, what, 8-1, and a team that went to the tournament last year, would have been great to have a victory over them as far as down the road is concerned when that NCAA tournament rolls around.
And that's nothing to take away from the Zips and Bob Huggins, because they have a very good program over there, and it's kind of a shame when the two teams play that a team has to lose.
Now, that was a tremendous basketball game.
Probably one of the best collegiate basketball games I have seen personally.
This telecast is presented by the authority of Cleveland State University. It is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Cleveland State or WOIO Television is strictly prohibited. That was a replay there of that. Bailey with 21.
Let's also point out the fact that we also have in the lineup Mike Raby, a walk-on from St. Ignatius. He is number 22 for the Cleveland State Vikings. These guys don't get that much playing time, and you always like to recognize them when they do get in. As we wind down the clock to no time remaining, and that is it.
A couple of last-second efforts, both missing the mark. Kevin Mackey congratulating the Kadesha staff and their players. And getting back to that one point, I think Kevin is very excited about the fact that his ball club is 8-2.
That's right, 8-2, and they score 82 points tonight, the 61 for Canisius. 61, the same amount of points that Canisius scored in the first game. But this time, of course, the Vikings scored more than the 66 they scored the first time.
And Al and I will be back to wrap up victory number 8 on the season for the Cleveland State Vikings. The final score, 82-61, and you're watching the victorious Cleveland State basketball Vikings on 19.
Ho, ho, ho. Believe it or not, I do go shopping once a year. There's a sale even Santa can't miss. Saul Bergman Jewelers 94th Annual Christmas Closeout.
Elegant diamond solitaire and wedding sets in all shapes. Striking round marquee and pear shapes and 14 karat solid gold. A quarter carat diamond from only $129.
Saul Bergman's Christmas Closeout is just like Santa. Here today, gone tomorrow. It's got my personal approval.
Out on the street, the beat never stops. When dawn breaks, another day starts. The heart of a city never rests. It's a part of your life. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city. Every morning never misses. The heart of the city hits the streets. It helps you to understand. Get your day started right. The Plain Dealer, the heart of the city.
Start your day with the Plain Dealer. Call 344-4600 for home delivery.
Hi, I'm Ed Mullinex. Every car, every truck is on sale during our 6-day year-end sell down. It's a buyer's market at Mullinex Ford, east or west, with over 1,500 cars and trucks. Buy any new Ford and get a $300 to $600 cash rebate. It's our goal to reduce our inventory by about 300 units. And now is your last chance for a tax break. Take a test drive this week, and we'll give you a video tax guide just for shopping at Mullinex Ford, east or west.
Cleveland State fans are milling out of Woodling Gym, and once again, Alan Davis, geez, what's that make Kevin now here? 36-2 overall in 4 years with a victory, 82-61 over Canisius, and it's victory number 8 on the season as far as the Vikings are concerned. And one gentleman who played a pivotal role in tonight's victory was Ken McFadden.
That is correct. He is our Miller Viking of the game, and you're going to see his stats in just a moment. 23 points for the Mouse. Had 22 the first time these two teams met. 2 rebounds, 8 steals, and I think that's the key statistic of the evening.
And the Mouse will receive a plaque, and also a donation will be made to the CSU Development Fund in the Mouse's name. And, of course, the good folks at the Miller Brewing Company supplying that. The Viking of the game, Ken McFadden. That was a tough decision, basically, too, because Clinton Ramsey had a heck of a game this evening.
20 points, and he really came on strong in the second half. But as we said earlier, we should spread it around a little bit. Clinton Ramsey did get the Miller Viking of the game the first time we telecast the game.
That's right, and there are still plenty more games to come. And Al and I will be back to wrap things up here from Whittling Gymnasium right after this message. You're watching Cleveland State Basketball on 19.
Your Lincoln Mercury Mercour dealers have 3 great front-wheel drive cars to get you through winter. Like Mercury Lynx. Buy one now and get 3.9 annual percentage rate financing or $300 cash.
Skills that PSI Institute can train you in now. For a future of success, for career training that works, call PSI Institute now at 771-6680. That's 771-6680. Call now.
It's headline-making news. Another eyeglass factory grand opening. This time in the North Olmsted area, specializing in 2-for-1 glasses and contact lenses. Get 2 complete pairs of glasses for just $49.95. Or get 2 complete pairs of contacts for just $39.95. Plus, as a grand opening special, receive a free complimentary pair of binoculars. Available right now at all Eyeglass Factory locations.
Join the fun on the next Late Show with Jeff Lorber performing his hit single, Facts of Love, and College Performer of the Year comic, Andy Andrews.
Next on 19, the Cleveland State Vikings host the Florida A&M Rattlers in live college basketball sports action.